Greetings. Welcome to Vanaheda Church of Christ, Windhoek, Namibia. We invite you to listen to a powerful message entitled True Love That Ushers Worship by Evangelist Anthony Ngabwe. Stay tuned and stay blessed.
We give you praise, O God. God, open our hearts, open our minds as we receive your word. And bless us, God, as we grow in your word. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. We may be seated. God is good. All the time. I can't hear that one. God is good. All the time. Wonderful, wonderful. Today we'll be looking at something very important in the word. We'll be looking at something very, very important. There's something I love about the Bible, you know. The Bible has been designed in a certain way. When you look at the Bible, there is an Old Testament. Now, the Old Testament tells you of the stories and people and things used to happen. When you come to the New Testament, it tells you about the story of Jesus and the disciples of Jesus. Now, for you to understand the New Testament, you need to have a background of the Old Testament. Now, today we'll be looking at something very important. And this concept we'll be looking at is something that we hear oftentimes. We all always. Now the concept is the love that ushers you into true worship. The true love of God that ushers you into true worship. Now understand, we'll read again the same verse we just read in the book of John. Let's go with me to the book of John. The true love that ushers you into the true worship. Now somebody will be wondering, like, how does love relate to worship? And that's what we are going to look at. How does true love relate to true worship? If you do not have love, then you don't understand worship. Then you cannot worship God if you do not understand love. Now, let's start by reading the same John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And He was with God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made, and without Him nothing was made that has been made. When you read verse 14, and the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us, and we have seen of His glory, and the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. Now you go to chapter 3 of John, chapter 3. I want us to read the familiar verse, which we all know. John 3:16. Now this is John 3, verse 16. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved. Now, the interesting thing about love is this. I'm talking about true love that ushers you into true worship. The interesting about love is that it comes to your need. It comes where you are. It meets you. I don't need to go to the suburbs. I don't need to go to Pioneer's Park. I don't need to go to a rich man's area to seek for love. But the interesting about love, it comes even to Wanaheda, even to Katutura where I am. So the love of God, instead of us, because we have failed to reach God in heaven, then God comes down. Where there is a sinful nature, where there's a sinful man with a sinful and wicked ways. There was a time that God was so grieved with a man's sin
The Bible says God was grieved. In other words, God even cried. God can laugh, God smiles, and God can cry. The Bible in Genesis, the Bible says, man's ways were so wicked and sinful that God was grieved. Now, despite that, the interesting about the love of God is that it comes down and meets you at your point of your need. I don't like people trying to fake it and try to try to measure love in a certain criteria, in a certain way. Are you seeing the love of God? Now, oftentimes, why did I bring up this topic? Oftentimes, we as Christians, we have the attitude of, I don't love sinful people. We talked about sinful people today. I don't love people that are in a certain behavior or certain environment that I'm not in. That is not love. Now, understand that you couldn't reach God when you are so sinful, but the love of God came down to you. Yet you are still sinful. The Bible says in the book of Romans that he loved us first, yet we were still sinners. Are you understanding the true love? We have now the fantasies and the faking love which the world is giving to us. And the world is deceiving everybody about love. Love has become so, you know, when I write in my poet says, I talk about love being so destructive. People using the word love to destroy others. In fact, if a man, especially nowadays, you find if a man wants to get anything from a woman, they say, I love you. Do they really mean it? That's the concept. And they put love in a certain kind of box. They say, okay, this is how love is supposed to work. But love is so powerful that surpasses all the boundaries, that surpasses every man's mistakes. Love looks beyond. I don't just look at your features. I don't just look at how you behave and how you talk and how you walk. But love looks beyond. And that's the nature and the true love I love about love. I'd love somebody to love me beyond my mistakes, beyond how I talk and how I think. I just need somebody to love me true, just like God loves me. Now, the interesting point is that you cannot love. Understand? A young man, when I was in the north last time, when we were seated in the car, he was walking, and he's talking about, Brother Anthony, I'm about to get married, but tell me something about love. And I began to say, young man, this is a thing that is happening. You cannot love. This is what I told him. I said, you cannot love unless you are connected to the source of love. Unless anybody, we were doing an interview with Jerry, and somebody asking, can people who are not Christian have love? They don't have love. They have fantasy. They have lust. They don't have love. Understand, people that have love are connected to God. Because the Bible says God is what? Love. In the first John. So if you do not connect to the stream, the source of love, you don't have love. Even you youths who are here, if your boyfriend, you know he's not a Christian, and you know he's not a church, he doesn't have love at all. Understand? He's just trying to deceive you, trying to just manipulate and get some stuff out of you. So the true love, I love about it. You can only understand love when you're connected to God, because the Bible says God is love. So any man that is not connected to God will not give you love. That's a fact. From now, begin to understand that. If you have a friend, anybody that is not connected to God, we complain too much about sinners. No, they did this. No, this is a thing they're doing, and the stuff and the stuff. Let me tell you, I don't expect sinners to love me because they don't have love. All they need is for me to love them because I'm the one having love. So whatever they do to me, I just understand it's their nature. Their nature is sinning. Okay? So don't expect any good. So me as a Christian is when I bring in, outshine my love upon their lives. Then they understand love. Love is not judgmental. Love is not criticizing. Love is understanding, forgiving. Love is so wonderful, so natural. I've gone through life and every time I go through certain stuff, I love how I release my anger and how I release and how I forgive people. Is that in art we are taught whatever you feel you express is through art. So sometimes whatever I'm going through, I'll sit down And I'm winding up on my book, the poetic book. And one of it, I talked about how I expresses how people misjudge me because of not understanding love. Right? How people, they categorize me or they put me in a certain class. Okay, they say, okay, you belong to this culture. You belong to this country. You belong to certain kind of group of people. So then my love is restricted. My love cannot reach you. That's a fake love. Love surpasses all boundaries. That's a pure love. God surpasses all the rhythm, all the nature of the heavens just to come down to your level. That's what I love about true love. That's what I love about true love. True love is not somewhere in the sky where you're going to find it. Or I love people sing a song like love is in the air. No, there's no such a thing. Love is not in the air. Love is with people who understand the words of God. Those are the fantasies people are giving. Love is in the air. Where do you see love in the air? Love lives in people. People express love. Now love, understand, love is not a word. Most of people who have written and who have acted and stuff, read novels about love. Love is not the word. Love is an action. I'm trying to break down so that you understand love. Love is not a word. Anybody that comes to you and seeing love, 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 and this stuff. Love is an action. Try to differentiate that. Love is an action. What God did say in heaven, I love the world so much. He didn't just sit and say, I love the world so much. He brought an action. He lowered himself, God himself, in a human flesh through Jesus. He came down to your need, to your point, to your sinful world, to your sinful nature. That's the thing I love about love. It comes down where you are. It comes down to your location. It comes down to your tribe. It comes down to your family. It comes down in every area of your life, in every weakness of you. That's the interesting about love. When love comes, I'm giving you the points so that when you see people, when you look at people, so that you be able also to display the same love and not be faking it and not be lying to people, say, I have love. I want you to have a genuine love, and you should understand how love relates to worship. Now understand love. When love comes to your level, this is what it does. You are so distressed. You are so rejected. Everybody doesn't love you. Everybody's saying all kind of stuff. When love comes down to you, it uplifts you to the glory. Love, when comes down to you, it takes you to another level of joy, of peace, of happiness. That's what love does. It takes you from where you are, from the garbage, from the stuff. It takes you up. That's a genuine love. Not love that comes, says, I love you, and they leave you the same. When you love me, when you come, even just with a loving word, I'll not be the same. At least I'll smile. At least I'll get sense. I was going in this direction. Then when love came in a poetic sense, when you read Solomon, he writes poets, he says, I was doing the stuff, but when love touched me, and then I ran into right direction. I was doing some stuff, but when I met somebody that taught me about the love of God, and then I moved into the right direction. That's what love does. It brings you back to the right path. It uplifts you to the position of glory. It does not look down on you. It does not do anything evil for you, but it brings you up. That's what love does. So that's the genuine love you can ever find when you talk about human beings with love. You need to have the love. You're not supposed to buy love or find it in some place. Or today you are a loving person, tomorrow you are another mood. A true child of God, no matter what situation they are going in, they are loving people. Like, I don't understand you. Even the troubles you are going through, you are so loving. Yeah. Because that's the true nature of a Christian. The Bible says rejoice always. And rejoice always. Right? So when I meet people who are loving, no matter what condition they are in, you see the bright face. No matter what the situation they are in, they will be able to respond to you in a loving way. That's an interesting thing about love. You have to have the nature, not a borrowed love. Like sometimes I have love and sometimes I do not. I'm just in the bad mood. Love is a nature. Yet not I who live, but Christ lives in me. Understand, I love, if Jesus really, that verse, do you know what that verse is? Galatians 2:20. Yet not I who live, but Christ lives in me. If really, if exactly Jesus were to live in my heart. And now, can I give you the picture of Jesus? Jesus meets a prostitute, and the people, the Pharisees, says she has committed adultery. The Bible or the prophet says we're supposed to stone her. What did Jesus say? He was a loving being. Is any one of you did not commit sin? Let him be the first to cast the stone. That's a loving heart. But what happened if you, some of them, just kill her. Some of us could have done that. But Jesus has a loving heart. Jesus meets the leprous people. You know the leprous were outcast. You're not supposed to draw close to them. You're not supposed to meet them. But Jesus, the Bible says, he touched them and he healed them. Touched them. Right? That's the love. Love touches you. It doesn't care how kind of situation or environment you're in, but love just touches you. That's a true nature of love. People have painted love in all the corners they can. But this is a genuine, true love from God. Now put people boundaries according to tribe, according to culture, according to our morals, according to our values, and this and that and that and that. They just keep on adding. You know, they become like the Pharisees themselves. Even Christians, they're there. You know? No, these ones, those ones, No, your job is not about doing some stuff. Your job is to show love. Our job is only to express what is in us. From the abundance of the heart, the man speaks. If what is in your heart, that is your only thing you can speak. It doesn't matter whether it's a joke or not. What is in your heart, that's what you're going to say. What is in your mind, that's what you become. Whatever you put in your mind. So if I begin to exercise, we've been dealing with even the sermons we've recorded on creating internal memories. We have CDs for free. You're supposed to get that and begin to listen at home. We talk about how you just become a loving being in whatever you are. You're just with people that whatever you do, when you move out of that place, you have just created an impact, an internal impact. Like whenever they are, wow! If Sister So-So was here, oh my goodness, she could have done this for me. And that's what love is all about. The Bible says wherever Jesus went, he never just came out of it like that. Wherever the disciples of Jesus went, they never used to leave the place the same. And that's a true nature of love. When you find somebody down, you don't leave them the same. There are people that sometimes with love you don't have to say anything. With love you can just, somebody can come with their troubles and stuff, and just you having an open heart and a listening ear, they'll feel better. They will feel better. Now we try to put all the stages about love and stuff like that, and we fail to reach at the point where we're supposed to be. Understand that. Now, Brother Antonov talked too much about love and stuff, how we're supposed to do stuff. How does love, true love, relates to true worship? Now understand how true love relates to true worship. This is how true love relates to true worship. I don't know in some cultures, but there are some cultures I've gone in some countries. A woman calls her husband my Lord. Yeah. A woman calls her husband my Lord. Now, we're now talking about worship. Worship is a lifestyle. Worship is not when we are gathered here like, okay, I've gone to church to worship. No. Worship is beyond what we are doing right here. Worship is a life, a daily lifestyle. It's what you live. It's who you are. It's what you talk. That's worship. When you walk in the nature which God created you, you're worshiping God. When I have my talent and I use it for the glory of God, I'm worshiping God. When I have words and I speak them for the glory of God, I'm worshiping God. Worship is a ritual beyond just church. It's our life style. So understand. So the woman calls her husband my Lord. Now we do worship in every form of life. Maybe you never knew that. Only that the worship we do, the worship we offer God, it has to differ from the worship we offer men. The problem comes according to Proverbs chapter 3 when you read verse 5, 6. It talks about, I've been acknowledged and I acknowledge God first. I seek the favor of God first, then men. But that verse is so interesting to me because there are some people who turn the verse upside down. They will now seek the favor of man first and then God comes second. That's where the trouble comes. When you begin to worship man and leave God the second. When you begin to worship your husband and leave God the second. When you begin to worship your school, your work, and God becomes the second. The problem comes in there. But the first thing we have to know, worship, you give all the glory and honor and everything, your life you have, to God. And then man second. But in every area of our life, we do worship. Worship means to acknowledge, to honor, to give praise, to give thanks. So you have given honor and praise and thanks to people. Right? Now, you need to understand that there is a difference when you give praise and honor and acknowledgement to people and when you give it to God. Now, when I love my husband, when I love my wife, I'll offer the true honor, the true praise. I'll offer the true worship to her. You understand how it links now? So when I don't have a true love, I'll try to fake it. When you understand how you love God, you will offer the true worship to God. In church, you will be real. Out of church, you'll be real. You offer the true worship to God. So when you don't have love, if you're being pushed to come to church, they have to force you. They have to SMS you. Well, how far are you? Where are you? Where you did not come? We are forcing you. Then you cannot worship God in spirit and in truth. Because worship comes out of love. God did not just bring us into to worship him. He ushered love first. Then we grasp and receive the love of God and say, God, thank you. I will worship you. I will praise you. Why? Because there was love first that came down. So it is the love that appears first. Then you understand the true worship that goes back to God. When you could never understand the true love of God, you will never worship God in spirit and in truth. Like Sister Linda was saying, if you'd come to church for any other reasons, that's why, please, I beg you, the CDs are for free. Get one and go and listen at home. I talk about these things. When you come to church for any other reason apart from worshiping God, you are coming for a wrong reason. Then that is not a true worship. When I come to see Brother Anton how he looks today, when I come to see who is singing, who is at church and who is not at church, who does what, when I come to show off what I have, then you are not in the true worship. The true worship is when you come first seeking God. So there are many folks, do you know what the Bible says? Many people won't go to heaven even if they go to church. Matthew chapter 21:7-21. You know why? Because they haven't grasped the love of God and the true worship. In those things I talk about how people seek crusades. Who is coming? From where? From South Africa? From Europe? They just look everywhere where there's a poster to see where there's a crusade. And they're not going there for any other reason. But true worship has to be linked with true love. That's how it goes together. Whenever you never understand the true love, you don't have the true love, you never worship God in spirit and in truth. Always, always. It doesn't matter how much you do it in the church. It doesn't matter how. There are people now begin to work in the church just out of obligation. Because of this, because that, maybe out of force, out of acknowledgement. They have to acknowledge me now that I'm working. They have to do that. One thing I'll tell you the fact, I don't come to church because I preach every Sunday. I don't come to church. There are times, you can ask those who were here months ago, Well, sometimes we just come, I don't preach, I don't stand here, and we'll just sit, we'll divide ourselves. We go there, you have a Bible study, we go there, you have a Bible study, and then you pray, then we come back, we pray, then we go home. That's a true worship. So, me, I don't come to church because some people have built in their mind that, okay, he comes to church because he has a responsibility to preach. Uh-uh. I come to God. I'm here to seek God just like you are seeking God. I'm here also to serve in God's kingdom faithfully. That's understanding the true worship and the love of God. We never understand love, we'll never have a true worship. A man, we deal with these cases all the time. A woman, a man who gets in any relationship, whether family, God, husband, what? There's always, now understand this, and for those who are growing up, you need to understand it very, very attentively because it's a very vital point. Often people have gotten into certain environment, certain relationship. Why? What are they looking for? Love. What are they looking for? Peace. Can I tell you something? You never find peace in marriage. I'll tell you the fact. You never find peace in any relationship. You never find peace anywhere. You have to usher peace. Peace has to come from you. When you get into that marriage, when you get into that relationship, you come along with your baggage of peace. I'm carrying my luggage of peace. You know, I don't care what I find in this relationship, but I'm carrying my luggage and my bag of joy, peace. I don't want any man to frustrate me. That's how it works. Young people, they're running after every man just looking for love. I'm looking for true love. Where? True love where? You got true love, you only get it from God. So when you ever enter in any relationship, you are coming with it. You have true love already. Where does it come from? God. True peace man cannot give, comes from God. Jesus said, I've come to give you peace. So when I have Jesus in my heart, then every relationship I enter into, I have my bag, my oxygen of peace. Right? That's why people when get into a relationship, they run out of oxygen because they didn't carry the bag and the oxygen of peace. And you are there, no, I'm getting frustrated, I'm getting stuff. I've done the study and the research. I've said it before. That's why I'm saying that you have many sermons are preached on DVDs. I did the research when I was talking about creating internal memories. And the research was there are 66 people committed suicide in Namibia from January to September. 66. 850 people reported attempting to commit suicide. Understand that. Now, Namibia has been rated like one of the countries that suicide is on very high in the world. No, I'm not talking about Africa. Namibia is rated as one of the highest countries in the world in terms of suicide. Do you know why? There's no peace, no love, no joy. That's a reason. So people, they need to understand, you don't go into marriage, into relationship looking for peace. That's why you get frustrated, then you hang yourself. Go to God, then he gives you peace, joy, righteousness. Then any relationship that comes, you check at them. They also have to bring peace. That's why they need to be connected to God. That's why the Bible says, do not be yoked with unbelievers. Do you know why? It doesn't mean we are any better than them, only that we go for a different solution than them. It doesn't mean we are better than the unbelievers. The problem comes when we have a problem in marriage, relationship. We go for a different direction to seek for help. So unbelievers, they go where? To the world. As we go where? To God. That's a difference. When the Bible says, do not be yoked with unbelievers, doesn't mean we're any better than them, but is that when there's a problem in the family, in marriage, in any relationship, in my schoolwork, my work, I go to a different source of help than the world does. So that's a concept. So all this is wrapped up understanding between love and worship. So you need to understand how love is so deeper. You can never finish talking about love. Love is so deeper. Deeper than we think. So I tell people, say, don't tell me all the fantasies of love. Show me love. I need somebody to demonstrate an action of love. That's why sometimes I would go to places, I didn't tell people I love everybody. I say, oh, you give them stuff, you show them attention that you love them. You don't even need to say I love you. But how you portray the attention, how you portray your sympathy, how you portray your help to them is already a word. And more than a word. So we need to understand these things. We are living in the end time so that we are different. I want us to grow. So that when people say you are different, in other words, you are different. You are different. You are different. So we'll continue and stuff like that. So then our love also. Now love, when you understand the love of God, it brings you close to God. It develops righteousness. It develops in you faithfulness. If you want to read, understand how faithfulness and love are working together and worship, you will find it in the book of Proverbs chapter 3. From 1, it says, my children, do not depart from this word, but put it in your heart. And let love and faithfulness never leave you. Because when you love something, when you love somebody, when you love whatever you love, you'll be faithful to it. There are people who know that my job is a source of bread. They love their job and they are faithful. They are always on time. The job says 8 o'clock, you are there 7:30. Right? We also have to develop the same love with God. We know church is 9 o'clock, we are here 8:30. But the thing is, we understand God is a loving God and a gracious God. Then Paul says, do not take for granted that love. Do not take for granted. Now let me go deeper a little bit. When you usher love into people, now understand, it's a very practical thing. When you usher love, when you give love out, you have to have principles to protect your love. When God gave us love, he had principles set. Why is it like that? It's like that because if I just open up my heart, a loving heart, even the devil himself will enter my heart and crush that love. There are Christians, I can tell you this is a fact. There are Christians that are being proposed by unbelievers and they take them to bed. Because why? They want that having loving heart. Love is not like that. When you have love, you also have discipline and principles. That's how love works. You need to have discipline and principles. You say, okay, my friend, I love you with the love of God, but I can't go this far. This is where I stop. I just came to help you, but not this part. So love has what? Principles. Most of the folks, so understand that love has to have principles. You don't just have to open up your heart and we need to love everybody. We need to love everybody, but we need also principles to guide our love that an enemy does not smash it down. Because there are people, you know, some of you know that I do counsel. There are people who'd come and for counseling say, I can't love anymore. I have hatred. And I'm not going far. Even myself, Anton, as you are saying, I had hatred on certain people because how I've been treated when I opened up my love to people. So when I go through the word of God now, the word of God tells me, so okay, Anton, you had love, you had opened up your heart to people, you didn't have what? Boundaries and principles. So now you have to have love people, but have boundaries and principles. So I would love you with a loving heart, but I need to have principles and boundaries. That's how true love works. So you become faithful to something that you love. Don't just, when you say you love something, you have to be committed to it. You know, don't say you love something, then let alone you're not committed. If you love church, you love Jesus, you have to be committed to it. Rather, don't say you love Jesus, because you're not committed to Jesus. Because so when you're committed, you usher the true worship in the presence of God. So I'm closing now. And I'll read the last verse so that we understand what love is all about. What love is all about. It's very, very vital that we understand the love of God.
that we understand the love of God. I'll read the same verse and I'll go to 17, John 3. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Verse 17 says, For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because he has not believed in the one, he has not believed in the name of the God's one and only Son. This is the vindicate of the light that has come into the world, but man has loved darkness instead of light, because their deeds were evil, and everyone who does evil hates light, and they will not come into light, for they fear his deeds will be exposed. Now I'll just wind up there with the word that we can give love to people, but people have to be willing to receive that love. I won't force my love on anybody. This is what Jesus says, whoever, this is a love of the world that I give my Son, but whoever now believes in this love will receive Jesus as the Son of God. So we still have a choice when love has been ushered to us, when the life of God has been ushered and given to us, we have a choice whether to receive the love or reject the love. So whenever you go out, I don't force people. I'll tell people about the Church of Christ. I'll tell people about Jesus. But I'll never drag you. I don't have that power. I don't have that energy. I'll tell you and I will show you the love. But brothers and sisters, don't expect me to be dragging you into worship. You need to have love. So God ushers the love. And people have to be willing to receive the love of God. And when you receive the love of God, you walk in that love. As you're walking just in the love, because love is an action. I said, I gave a definition. Love is not a word. It's an action. So as you do the actions of love, love of words only is not love, but as you do the actions of word, those actions are called into worshiping God. Every time you love somebody, every time you forgive somebody, every time you give a gift to somebody, I appreciate you, the church, what you did yesterday, the Sunday school came here, you bought them Bibles, you fed them. That is love in action. So each time you do that as a church, you do that as an individual, you are ushering love and you are giving the love of actions and not words. And the children and everybody receive love with gladness. So you make an impact in their lives. Now understand that as I close up, everything you're going to do in your life, whether it's a word, an action, everything you're going to do is intentional. There is no word that is spoken that is just ending here. Everything you're going to do, it's intentional. It's recorded in your memory. It's recorded in heaven. That's why it's very, very important on what we do. So we should develop the love of God in us so that we move in the actions of love, you know, the actions of love. So when we move in the action of love, there's no judgment upon our lives. So bad. God loves you so much. God loves you dearly. And he is expecting you to receive that love and walk in that love. God bless you. Let us pray. We thank you, God. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you adoration, O God. We thank you, God, for your divine love. For your powerful love that surpasses every man's understanding. The love that surpasses every barrier and every place, O God. We have been so sinful, but still you loved us and you gave Jesus to die for us on the cross.
We appreciate and we give you praise and honor, God, for your true and unfading and undying love for our lives. And pray that, God, as you, God, usher the Spirit of Jesus into our spirit, that we may continue to grow and walk in your divine love. That, God, through our love, we may shine out, oh God, in the dark world. We may bring men and women, God, who are in a dark situation because of the love to you, Jesus, only. We pray, Heavenly Father, Lord, as we are leaving, God, others will be going to different places for holidays, others will be here, that, God, we shall be faithful as we are truly loving you, God. We shall be, God, continue to serve you wherever we shall be, oh God. We pray, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, and I pray, God, for your divine, God, protection and provision, God, as I'll be going on my way on Thursday, God, to South Africa. And I pray that, God, you shall be the pilot, and God, the pilot shall be the passenger. I give you praise, God, and I give you honor. We thank you, God, for also the Sunday school and the adult to be going to different places for holiday or for any other thing. We just pray that, God, your divine power, your divine protection may be upon their lives. We pray for our sisters and our brothers all over, God, the world of Church of Christ, God. God, for those who have been wearing, for those who have maybe, God, backslided, that, God, you give them vision again. You bring them back to the straight path of love because you are loving. And through your love, God, you have received life, which is Jesus. Father, we give you praise and honor. We pray, Lord, as we end the service today, God, that you guide us.
Thank you for listening. For more information, please call us on 081-406-3967 or let us be friends on Facebook, Vanaheda Church of Christ. Stay blessed.
Há uma palavra que se diz no